being with us today, and Paul Babcock, the Director of the Office of Public Health and Safety. Also on our WebEx this morning is the Chief Deputy Mayor and Chief of Staff, Thomas Cook. Throughout this crisis, we have worked closely with our partners at the state, including Governor Eric Holcomb, his staff, and Dr. Christina Box. Now, this Friday, tomorrow, our state leaders, it is my understanding, intend to provide guidance on the next steps that we will all take as a state, together, as one Indiana, because we are all in this together. This will likely include recommendations on the phased reopening of our economy and the methodical, data-driven way that communities throughout Indiana can begin removing restrictions in response to what we hope will be the plateau and then the diminishment of this outbreak. Now, this is important work, and I want to take time at the very outset to thank Governor Holcomb for the efforts that he and his staff, the state of Indiana's Department of Public Health, have made. I believe that they will pay dividends, not only throughout Indiana, but particularly here in Indianapolis, when we are ready to start that process. But in order to provide predictability and certainty for the residents of the city of Indianapolis, I want to send a clear message. Our efforts and our sacrifices are working, but to the greatest extent allowable under the new state orders, we will be maintaining our current stay-at-home restrictions for another 2 weeks through and including May 15. I know that continues to be disruptive, and in many cases, I'm sure that it is disappointing. In a perfect world, we would remove all the restrictions and not worry about this anymore. But we all know this isn't a perfect world. In just over a month's time, nearly 1,000 Hoosiers have lost their lives due to a virus that has fundamentally changed the way we live our lives. And I want to assure you that Dr. Kane and I have not come to this conclusion lightly, nor have we come to it alone. Health officials at every level, along with the lived experience of our city's brave healthcare workers, have all told us the same thing. And that message has been loud and clear. We are not in the clear yet. Corporate leaders and groups representing employers and employees have all told us that prematurely reopening the economy and thereby perhaps setting back the progress we have made would do more harm to business and employees in the long term than what has already occurred. And we do not want to go through this again. Perhaps most critically, the data that we are receiving, including the hundreds of new cases just over the last few days, tells us that while we are making progress, we are not there yet. We are, however, at a stage where our actions over the next couple of weeks will dictate the route ahead for many months. And it is because we wish to pursue the fastest responsible path toward reopening our economy that I make a request of our residents today. Indianapolis, I am asking for your bravery, your patience, and your serious commitment, as you have shown over these last couple of months. your continued serious commitment to slowing the spread of the virus over these next 2 weeks. Our city has already done a tremendous job of adapting, not only our healthcare workers, but our grocery store workers, delivery drivers, warehouse workers, food pantries. All of those people are true heroes because they have behaved as heroes. And the best possible way to honor those heroic acts is by doing what we can to abide by recommendations from our health and public safety personnel. As a final matter, before I turn this over to Dr. Kane, I also think it's important to provide a message of hope and a message of optimism. With news of increased testing in both Indianapolis and around the state, residents should be assured that we are gathering the tools that we need and that we will need to begin reopening. It is my hope that with additional guidance from the state that will come as early as tomorrow, we will soon be able to provide information on how Marion County can reopen over the next few months, so long as the data dictates that we can. We are winning this fight, but what we do today, what we do tomorrow matters just as much, if not more, than what we have already done. I'm proud of Indianapolis. The days ahead are not going to be easy, but over these last few months, we've proven that we can flatten the curve, that we can change the trajectory, and that we're on the right path. For now, I'm asking that we stay the course. So I'd like to hand it over to Dr. Kane, who can provide more details for all of us. Thank you, Dr. Kane.
Thank you, Mayor Hogsett. And let me just say, I just want to thank you for your leadership and your guidance in terms of protecting the safety of our citizens. As most of you may not know, Indianapolis now has a total of 5,750 cases, and we haven't had the update yet of this morning. 5,295 cases. And as a result, we have a total of 305 deaths. But I would want to emphasize to you that we are still having over 100 new cases per day. And so while we are, and I have to applaud this community for following our rules in terms of our stay at home shelter requirements, we still have a significant way to go, as our Mayor Hogsett has stated. And so again, keep up that good work. I'm also honored to say that we're excited about this new testing going into our communities. So we will start out this week with doing at least 1,000 to anywhere from 1,000 to 1,500 tests starting this week and next week, with the opportunity of expanding almost as much as 3,000 tests a week or more as we are starting to identify new sites. So look to hear our announcement for our next site next week, and we hope to be starting an additional site. But again, want to thank Pastor Jeffrey Johnson of Eastern Star for allowing us to utilize his church at 5750 30th Street, where we are actually starting today. So please join us. Those hours are from 10 to 6 p.m., but we are requiring that you register. And on our website, it gives you the number that you can call. You can register by phone if you do not have computer access. No problem. We have plenty of callers in order to start registering you by telephone. And so hope to have an exciting, vibrant day today. We know we've already got 500 calls already, people trying to register for our testing. So we want to assure you we're going to handle those individuals, really emphasizing our seniors, people who are immunocompromised, anybody that's symptomatic, that looks like they have flu-like symptoms. We definitely want to test you, and anybody that's like a frontline person. So do delivery. So if you had a retail providing a service and you're a frontline person, come to us. We will be happy to test you. You don't require doctor's office order, nor do you have to provide any money. This is a free test on behalf of the city of Indianapolis. So please come in and join us and get yourself a test. I'm also delighted to say that we are reopening our golf courses. As you know, we had closed those golf courses earlier, which allowed us to take our time to work with the golf associations where we could set up a more strict precautions and set up a monitoring process in order for us to assure ourselves that we are having social distancing processes in place in order for us to protect our communities. And lastly, I'm excited with being able to provide a expanded opportunity to increase our food availability by opening up our farmers market. And so I'm excited about that. It will give our citizens more opportunities in order to have a more diverse background of food availability. So I think some of you have caught some of the news that, you know, we may be having the possibility of a lack of some of our meat supply. And so anytime we can increase our opportunity, our food opportunity for our individuals, we are very, very grateful. And so I do want to shout out to my incident commander for our drive-through testing, Mr. Madden, who's just done a magnificent job with his team of getting our testing sites available. And so we want to continue to invite anyone who wants to be a site to talk with us, and we're delighted to have discussions related to that. But we want to be able to say of our testing sites that we're putting our sites at all different neighborhoods, east, west, and increasing our sites where our hot spots are in order to really identify those individuals who are positive, so we can continue to do contact tracing and to put those precautions up for anybody that might have been exposed. So, but I do want to thank everybody's been involved in that process. So many community partners have stepped up to the plate. And so we appreciate that. So thank you very much. You know, and just say again, thank you, Mayor Hogsett, for your leadership.
Thank you, Dr. Kane. We'll now open it up for questions. Our first one comes from Russ Quay at Fox 59.
Okay.
Russ, oh, yep. There you go.
How about now?
There you go.
There you go. All right. Well, we're off to a good start. Good morning, everybody. Babcock, quit smiling. That's a question for both Dr. Kane and for the mayor. Your reaction to the announcement that Simon Properties is going to reopen this weekend, properties they either own or manage. Did the administration have any opportunity to offer input to Simon into this decision? What are your fears if these properties do reopen, that it could cause the virus to kick into its second stage again? And if I'm not mistaken, I think Circle Center is operated by Simon, but it's either owned by the city or by an authority. And Mayor, as the representative of the authority that owns the property, can you override Simon's decision to open up Circle Center?
Sir, let me just, can I just, can I talk first before the mayor? Sorry, Mayor. From the public health perspective, we're very concerned about letting a large retail establishment be open when we're still having greater than 100 cases a day. So when we already have over 100 cases a day, open up a large retail establishment would just really increase our numbers dramatically, put other citizens at risk considerably, and it may undo all the good work we have put in place related to our shelter in place and staying at home philosophy. So huge concerns. If you look at the state of Georgia, they're already starting to see new cases increase as a result of their mandate of letting all the businesses reopen. So very, very concerned about it. I'll have to let the mayor weigh in or Paul Babcock weigh in about have they had any input in this decision related to Simon opening up. I can only just personally say I have not been involved yet.
Yeah, Russ, thank you for the question. First of all, it is the executive orders issued by Dr. Kane that will control what happens over the next 2 weeks. We follow her lead as the leading public health official for Marion County. Now, Simon Property Group is a great corporate community partner. We will be having conversations, teleconferences with the leadership of Simon Property Group this afternoon. And so I would defer to Thomas Cook, who will take a leadership role in those conversations for an update as to where we are as it relates to Simon Property Group and its desire, its understandable desire, to help help the process of reopening the economy. Thomas?
Appreciate that, Mayor. The one comment I would make about this is that we will be having conversations with Simon Property Group, frankly, and other business and corporate leadership throughout the day, throughout the next few days, and frankly, throughout the next few weeks. And although their announcement dealing with a planned reopening for this weekend is not allowable under our current orders and will very likely not be allowable under our future local orders, I will say that there is a much benefit in corporations and businesses, small and large, to be doing the work that I know Simon Property Group and others are doing to prepare for reopening. And so to the extent that the actual date of their reopening of their local facilities may be in question, I will say that the work that I believe they are doing to analyze and adopt best practices will bear fruit when we do come to a point where those types of reopenings can occur. And our office, along with Director Babcock and the health department, will be talking with them about what those preparations can look like. We are hopeful that those conversations will lead us on a path forward over these next few weeks and these next few months.
Could I add one additional thing? You know, I think if you look at the numbers for the state of Indiana, it looks like we are slowing down significantly our cases. But I want to emphasize, while the entire state looks like they're significantly decreasing in the number of new cases that they have, Indianapolis and some of the larger cities are unique, and they're a little bit different because we have a much higher population density compared to when you look at the entire state. And so when you look at those dynamics, that we have a higher concentration of people in one area, and we are at a much larger risk for the spread of disease, you have to take that in context in terms of making decisions about whether we are ready for any large retail establishments to be open. But I think the next 2 weeks, at least for us locally, based on our numbers, will help us get and be in a better position in terms of helping to make that decision as well, too. Thank you.
Sam Quinn, IBJ.
Can you guys hear me okay? Okay, my question is sort of in relation to how this will work. The city's order will work with the state order. That's a little unclear to me. So if the governor, say, opens up the economy, or opens up Indiana and relaxes the statewide stay-at-home order, will Marion County's extended stay-in-place order remain? How does that work in terms of what order would prevail?
Well, Sam, it would be our intent, depending on what the state proposes for the next couple of weeks, it would be our intent when that's announced tomorrow to take all of those factors into consideration and work collaboratively, cooperatively with the governor and his staff in implementing the state's orders. What Dr. Kane and I are attempting to do is provide the residents of the city of Indianapolis and all the residents of Marion County with a predictability upon which they rely. And it is in our considered judgment that while we all desire to reopen the economy, that as Dr. Kane just explained, the city of Indianapolis and Marion County are unique. And we have nearly or a little over in total population 900,000 people. So the density with which we live is not shared in other counties of the state. And as Dr. Kane, I think, identified statistically earlier in her comments, throughout the duration of this pandemic in Indiana, Marion County has consistently experienced at least a third, if not more than a third, of all presumptive positive coronavirus COVID-19 diagnosis. We also have consistently experienced nearly a third, if not slightly over a third, of all COVID-19 related deaths. And as a result, we are simply suggesting that Indianapolis has a fundamentally different perspective because of those statistics and because of those positions that may very well be substantially different than other areas of the state. The governor, when we will work very closely and collaboratively with Governor Holcomb and his staff, the governor has to keep into consideration the needs, the desires, the pressures, and the vulnerability of all 92 counties. Dr. Kane and I have the unique responsibility for charting a course for the city of Indianapolis and the Marion County residents. And I don't think we will be at odds with the governor, but if the state, through our governor, tomorrow articulates fundamentally different directives or lessens restrictions, we certainly will work with them in trying to implement those as consistently as the message that we're offering today.
And Mayor, one other thing I think we can inform the public about, some of the criteria that we look at. We look at our IEMS, our first responders, ambulance runs, and looking at those numbers, how many we're still continuing to have. The other thing, our MESS coalition, which is a coalition of all the hospital systems. We look at the number of folks who are in critical care, who are on ventilators. So all of that plays a major role in terms of what factors we use to say that we think is safe from a public health perspective. And Mayor, the other problem you have, you're just too popular. We have too many people coming outside the county trying to visit the city of Indianapolis. So if you open this up, oh my God, Illinois, Ohio, you know, if you wouldn't be so popular, we'd be fine. Thank you, Mayor.
Abdul Hakim Shabazz.
Good morning, Mr. Mayor.
Hi, Abdul.
Just a couple of questions, one for you and one for Dr. Kane. I just make sure we're clear, unless the governor administration gives otherwise, Simon Malls will not be allowed to open their properties this weekend under Indianapolis current stay-at-home order. I know Thomas said you guys are going to have conversations, but I'm just trying to make sure we're clear, because it seems like unless something changes, that answer is no. And for you, Dr. Kane, there's been a question at the state level about nursing homes and the number of COVID-19 cases and deaths have been associated with them. Is there a way for us to get a list of those here in Marion County? Because as you know, a lot of people have family members who are in nursing homes. My mother was in one last year before she passed away. And folks not being able to know what the COVID-19 situation is, it can cause a lot of unnecessary stress and hardship.
Dr. Kane, you want to handle that second?
Yes. So what I will tell you, at least for the long-term care facilities, the Indiana State Department of Health is overall responsible for the long-term care facilities. We provide assistance sometimes for them in regard to long-term care facilities, but they're the ones who have all the information related to the long-term care facilities. We do not. So you would need to get that information from them.
And Abdul, as it relates to your first question, I mean, given the statistics and where we find ourselves today, and I've tried to make this clear, decisions regarding how we move forward and what happens in the city of Indianapolis and the state of and Marion County over the next 2 weeks, those decisions are by necessity driven by public health experts and public health officials. Look, I understand the frustration and the disruption that these restrictions impose on businesses. I also profoundly respect the position of the Simon Property Group, who, as I said earlier, has been a wonderful community and corporate partner for the city of Indianapolis. I have great confidence that in conversations that take place this afternoon with Simon Property Group leadership and with the state of Indiana and in conjunction with the governor's directives, that we will be able to resolve our differences of opinion and go forward together as one community and one state for the betterment of all the residents of the state of Indiana. At the end of the day, Abdul, I just simply say, while I understand the frustrations that businesses feel, as the leader of the city, here's what we face. We have an invisible virus. It is amongst us. It is highly contagious and remains so. And it is killing Indianapolis, Marion County, and Indiana residents. And the health experts tell me that a vaccine probably will not be available until 2021. It is only the responsible thing. It is only the moral thing to make sure that all residents in Indiana are safe, are healthy, and are protected. We want to move as responsibly forward as quickly as possible. But for the next 2 weeks, I'm asking the city of Indianapolis and its residents to exhibit bravery, to exhibit patience, and to exhibit responsibility. And so as the month of May progresses, we may very well be in a fundamentally different position while we address these issues.
We have two more questions. The next one is Janet Williams with the State House file.
Good morning. This has to do with what the governor and Dr. Box were talking about yesterday in addressing the idea of when is it safe to really open up the state. The governor and both Dr. Box both said that they're looking at more than the number of cases, such as whether there's enough capacity at local hospitals to handle it. I'd really like, especially Dr. Kane, I'd really like your thoughts on that and how you factor those numbers into your own decision making. Thank you.
Okay. So one of the things that we look at, we have a special predictive modeling software program that's been developed by Dean Paul Havison and his team that uses a model from the University of Washington combined with a CDC modeling process where they are able to help predict when our critical beds may be at full capacity and our ventilators may be at full capacity. And so one of the things we're monitoring very closely is I believe that they implemented that we could go back to elective surgeries. And so we're watching that and monitoring that closely, because once you initiate elective surgeries, depending on the percentage of elective surgeries prior to this coronavirus epidemic, if they go slow and gradually, then I think we're fine. But if we start implementing it up to like 100% capacity, then I may have some greater concerns related to, will I have enough ventilators, critical care rooms, if they're now being taken up by people who are processing elective surgeries. So we're going to look at that based on our modeling standpoint. And of course, we're always in discussions with our hospital systems. I know Dr. Box, our Indiana State Health Commissioner, is monitoring that very carefully, as well as our Mesh Coalition. These are all of our emergency hospital systems. So we're all looking at that together and reflecting on their availability of those particular criteria, as well as we're going to be continuing. You know, it's really important that this community testing is done, because we know that there are a lot of individuals out there that have no symptoms, but they are contagious. So we have to drastically increase our testing, do our contact tracing. I know Christina and I have talked immensely related to this, and I know that they're going to do a very aggressive job of hiring people to do contact tracing. And so we're looking for that technical assistance from them related to that. And we're going to get training for all of our folks that we are going to try to recruit to related to this very issue. And so until we'll have a feel about going out into the community and doing more testing, what that'll look like 2 weeks from now. So if I have a lot of positives that I hadn't identified before, I'm going to say, whoa, we may have a greater number of positives out here than we realize. And so that will give us one of the main criteria that we'll be looking at.
And our last question is from Stephanie Zeppelin at Wish TV. Stephanie? Stephanie's question in the chat box is, what is the time frame on the next 2 weeks and when might we know what happens next?
Well, so today, Dr. Kane will issue executive orders and that will cover us from the deadline that we imposed a month or so ago of May 1. That will cover us up through and including May 15. We'll be over the next 2 weeks in constant communication, not only with each other as Marion County public health leaders, Dr. Kane and her staff, but we will continue to assess on minimally a weekly basis, but frankly, in all candor, a daily basis, in conjunction with Dr. Box, Governor Holcomb, and the state of Indiana. So while today's announcement is to continue the restrictions largely, with the exceptions that Dr. Kane has articulated that are lessening restrictions in just certain areas. Those restrictions will continue for the next 2 weeks, but we remain hopeful that the data and the metrics that Dr. Kane just talked about will show in even greater detail a faster flattening of the curve and a less volatile environment and atmosphere so that we can start. And by the way, we will use these 2 weeks to have conversations with leaders throughout the community, as we have in the past, about not only more testing and how that testing is administered, not only talking about workplace changes that are going to have to take place when businesses do reopen. And then, as Dr. Kane indicated, obviously contact tracing and the need to isolate people who are positive in their diagnosis. So we'll have ongoing conversations with business leaders and the business community generally, as well as taking direction from our public health officials.
We have one additional question, which is Mary Mills from WTHR.
Hey there, Mayor. Question for you. You can hear me, right?
Yes, Mary.
Okay. I'd like to know when you heard from Simon about their plans to reopen the mall. Did they basically ask you if they could reopen, or did they tell you? Also, have you been talking with the governor's office about this as well, and are you guys on the same page?
Yeah, Thomas may have a bit of a different perspective because he's been the lead person in communication on this regard. Candidly, Mary, I think the first I heard about Simon Property Group's desire to open up their properties, not just here in Indiana, but throughout other places in the country, I think I first heard about that desire in a question that was presented the governor during one of his press availabilities. Thomas, you may have more to say about that, but I think in all candor, I heard about it from a member of the press asking the governor about this very issue. No one from Simon Property Group has reached out to me directly, although they are going to be reaching out this afternoon to our office. Thomas?
Yes, Mayor, that's accurate. We had representatives from the company reach out to us after they made their public announcement, and we had planned to talk to them today. Obviously, as I said earlier, while their announcement of what I'm sure they would consider to be a best case scenario, which is opening this weekend, may not be particularly feasible under the restrictions that we believe we will maintain local authority to mandate here in Indianapolis, I do believe, again, that there are efforts that the company is taking that will be valuable for them in terms of taking a look at what their properties will need to look like when we get to that point. And one of the things that I know Dr. Kane and the mayor and Paul and others have been working on is that we're going to be very respectful of the state's guidance this later this week. And frankly, it will be beneficial to the city of Indianapolis, even if we believe that we will be permitted to have our phasing of reopening run on a slightly different timeline. There are different counties in Indiana, there are different regions in the state that are experiencing different types of manifestations during this outbreak. But the governor's office has been in constant communication with us. In terms of what their efforts have been, both on the policy-making side and on the public health side, that communication has been invaluable. And frankly, we, like every other region of the state, even if we may believe that from a local perspective, the data suggests we might need more time before we begin the reopening process, we are going to absolutely rely upon the way that reopening should occur when it does occur. So whether it's a large corporate partner like Simon Property Group, whether it's a small business or a restaurant, the state has been providing us incredible partnership on this. We have been providing them with the best information we have here locally. At the risk of stealing the trademark of the mayors and the governors, right, we are still going to be all in this together, even if there are differences at the local level over the next few weeks that potentially may exist. Under the statewide guidance as we each respond to the information we have available.
Thanks all. Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you.